Let's work through the following optimization problem together. To avoid extra postage fees, a package must be box-shaped with sum of length, width, and height no more than 64 inches. What dimensions will give the greatest volume for a box with a square base? Okay, so here we want to maximize the volume of the box. So therefore, this is an optimization problem. So let's follow the steps we've developed during this lesson to solve these kind of problems. So the first step is to, of course, read the problem carefully, which we just did, and then after that to draw a picture to illustrate the situation, and then also to identify and name variables. So I already have the kind of the basis for a picture here, right? I have my box, and now I just need to label my variables. Okay, so we're told something about the box in the last sentence. We're told that this is going to be a box with a square base. So I know the dimensions of the base are going to be the same. So I'm going to call that W. So the base is W by W. And then, of course, a box has three dimensions, length, width, and height. So I need a variable for the height. I'm just going to call that H. Okay, so I have all my dimensions named. I've taken care of naming my variables. So what's the next step? The next step in general is to identify what you actually want to optimize and then write a function or a formula that describes that quantity in terms of the variables you've established. Okay, so what are we actually trying to optimize here? Well, what we're trying to do is we're trying to find the dimensions that will give the greatest volume. Okay, so that tells us that we want to maximize volume. So therefore, we need to come up with a formula for the volume of this box. Well, in general, for any box shape, volume is length times width times height. It's going to be the same in this case. So here, we've got W times H, which is going to give us W squared H. Okay, so volume equals W squared H is what we want to maximize. All right, what's the next step? The next step is to identify any constraint equations, and then also write those in terms of the variable. So let's see if there's any constraints on our box that are given to us in the problem. Well, it says to avoid extra postage fees, we want the package to have sum of length, width, and height no more than 64 inches. So that's a constraint, right? So let's write an equation to represent that. Okay, so this is our constraint. And we want length plus width times height to be no more than 64. So we want the volume of our box to be as large as possible, right? So we want to take full advantage of that 64 inches. So I want then W plus H, so that's the sum of the dimensions of the box, to equal 64. Okay, or I could write that as 2W plus H equals 64. Okay, so now I have my optimization equation and my constraint equation. So what's the next step? The next step is to use the constraint to eliminate all but one independent variable in my optimization equation. So if you look at my optimization equation, which was the volume function, volume equals W squared H, right now there's two independent variables there, W and H. But I only want one independent variable in my optimization function. So I need to eliminate one of the variables, and the way I do that is by using my constraint equation. So if I take my constraint equation, I can either solve for H or W in this equation and then substitute that into the volume equation. And it doesn't matter which one I solve for. I think H looks like it's a little easier in this case, so I'll solve for H. If I do that, I get H equals 64 minus 2W. So I'm going to take that and plug it in for H in my volume formula, thereby eliminating a variable. So let's do that. Okay, so volume equals W squared H, but we have an expression for H, which is 64 minus 2W. Okay, so this gives me volume equals 64W squared minus 2W cubed. Okay, good. So now I have volume in terms of only one variable. So what's the next step? The next step is to find the appropriate interval for the independent variable. In other words, what values of that variable make sense? And sometimes this requires a good bit of thought. It's not always given explicitly in the problem. So in this case, our independent variable in our volume equation, which is here, is W. So I need to think about the values of W that make sense in this problem. Okay, remember W is the width, right? The width of the base. The base is W by W. Okay, so coming up with a lower bound for W is easier, right? Because W is a physical quantity. We know it can't be negative. Okay, so it has to be greater than 0. Now, I'm not including 0 in this interval because it wouldn't make sense for a dimension to be 0, right? Then the box wouldn't exist, right? That doesn't make sense. So we want W to be strictly greater than 0. All right, but what about an upper limit on our width? Let's think about that. So sometimes there might not be an upper limit in some physical problems. You know, maybe you can make the box as big as you want. But remember, in this case, we have this constraint, right? We're trying to avoid these excess postage fees. So we want the sum of length, width, and height to be no more than 64 inches. And we wrote that back here, if you remember. Or here, 2W plus H equals 64. So let's think. To fit into that constraint, what's the biggest that W could be? Or what do we want the boundary of W to be? Well, if you think about it, W has to be less than 32, right? Because if W was 32, then there wouldn't be any dimension left for the height of the box, right? Because 2 times 32 already gives us 64. So it couldn't be 32. There'd be nothing left for the height. And then, of course, it couldn't be more than 32 because then I would exceed the 64 inches I'm trying to stay within. So then W has to be less than 32 inches to fit into this constraint that we've established. Okay, so now I have my interval for W. W has to be between 0 and 32 inches. Okay, so what's the next step? Well, now we're ready to actually optimize this equation, which means find the absolute maximum or minimum, whichever applies, of this equation on this interval. Now, in this case, we're looking for an absolute maximum. Okay, so we want to find the absolute maximum. Okay, now notice the situation here. We want to find the absolute maximum on an open interval. Now, the only way we're going to be able to do that is if there's only one local max or min on that interval. So we'll hope that that's the situation, but let's go through the work and find out. Okay, so in general, to find the absolute maximum or minimum of any quantity, I'm going to want to take the derivative and look for the critical points. So let's go ahead and take the derivative of V. Okay, so V prime is going to give me 128W minus 8W squared, or sorry, minus 6W squared, 3 times 2, minus 6W squared. Okay, so that's my derivative of the volume function. Remember that critical points can occur when the derivative equals 0 or does not exist. Now for this derivative, this is just a quadratic polynomial. There are no places where this doesn't exist, right? This exists for all W. So then we want to proceed to the places where this would equal 0. So I want to set it equal to 0. 0 equals 128W minus 6W squared, and then solve for W. So I could factor out a 2 and a W from each of these terms, and I'd be left with 64 minus 3W equals 0. Okay, so I get one solution of W equals 0, and then my other solution would be W equals 64 over 3, right? we would get 64 equals 3W, and then divide by 3, so to get W equals 64/3. But let's check these solutions and make sure they're in our interval. So W equals 0 actually isn't in the interval we're looking at, so we don't need to think about that. But W equals 64/3 is, and 64/3 is approximately 21.3. Okay. So now that we have this critical point, we need to check and see if it's a local maximum or minimum. So, and let me back up a step. So remember, when you're trying to find an absolute extremum on an open interval, there's a theorem that says if there's exactly one local extremum on that interval, then that local extremum is your absolute extremum. And either it's an absolute max or min, depending on whether it was a local max or min. So we look like we're kind of on the track to getting to a point like that. But right now we need to check and see if this critical point is a local max or a local min before we know for sure. Now there's several ways you can do that. You can use the first derivative test or the second derivative test. Let's use the first derivative test in this example. But you're welcome to use either. So in the first derivative test, we check the sign of the first derivative around that critical point. So I'm going to make a number line, and I want to put values of W. So here it's 64/3 that I'm interested in. And then I want to check the sign of V prime. Now, these aren't critical points, but I'm just going to put our boundaries on this number line so we just know we're not concerned with values 0 or less or 32 or greater. Okay, so let's test some values. So 64/3 we said was approximately 21.3. So if I want to test something in this interval here, I could use 1, for example. So V prime of 1. Okay, so I'm going to use V prime, I'm going to use my factored form, 2W times 64 minus 3W. So let's see, if I plug in 1 to that, 2W is going to be positive, and 64 minus 3 is going to be positive. So this is going to be positive overall. Now for my other interval, let's see, I want something greater than 21.3, but less than 32, so I don't know, I could pick something like 30. So if I plug that in, well, 2 times 30, that's positive. But then I get 64 minus 90, so that's negative. So positive times a negative gives me a negative overall. Okay, so now I know the derivative is positive, and then it's negative. So that tells me that V, right, the original volume function, is increasing until we get to this critical point, 64/3, and then it's decreasing. So what does that tell me about what's happening at 64/3? It tells me this is a local maximum. So it looks like we're going to be able to use our theorem that we hoped we would be able to use, right? Since there's only one local extremum on this interval, and it's a local max, and it's an open interval, then we know that this is the absolute maximum. Okay, so let me write that out for us. Okay. So, since there is only one local extremum on this open interval, the local max is the absolute max, and it occurs when W equals 64/3. Okay, so we know that we found where the absolute maximum occurs, but now I just want to go back and check and see what the original equation was the original question was actually asking for, and make sure we specifically answer that question. Okay, so what were they actually asking for? What dimensions will give the greatest volume? Okay, so we need to list the dimensions in the box. All right, so we know one dimension, right? We know the max happens when W equals 64/3. Okay, so we know Okay, so these are the dimensions. We know W equals 64/3, and that actually gives us two dimensions of the box, right? Because our box is W by H, but we need to figure out what H is going to be. So remember we came up this relationship here, H equals 64 minus 2W, so we can use that to find H. Okay, so H equals 64 minus 2W. So 64 minus 2 times 64/3. And if you work that out, either by hand or on your calculator, you're going to find that H also equals 64/3. Okay, so then the final dimensions are 64/3 by 64/3 by 64/3. And actually, if you do these kind of optimization problems a lot, you'll find that this kind of thing happens. It's always going to be a cube or a square shape that optimizes the volume or the area. But anyway, we've found the dimensions that gives the greatest volume for this shape of box under the given constraints.